Welcome to our committee of the whole meeting. We start out with our first agenda item is legislation review. City manager, please.
Thanks, Mayor. I'm going to go off of the revised agenda that you all received via email last week. It was also updated on our website. So up first is Resolution 78. Wait, right one. Of course, I'm in the wrong agenda. Hang on. One second. Okay. First up is Resolution 78, 2020, which is a resolution condemning the murder of George Floyd by Minneapolis Police Department, declaring racism a public health crisis, and expressing support for statewide legislation to combat racism and implement best police practices to address racial bias and improve police community relations. I know that several members of council provide input on this particular resolution. Not sure if there's any additional comments or questions at this time.
Well, I requested that timeframe for the number of shootings involving Cleveland residents. I don't know if that was being added or not.
And I think Jason had mentioned that we could probably get this added, since it's not first reading, right here, so that we can still pass it today. Is that right, Bill?
To get the change added, did you say?
Yeah, since it isn't first reading yet until we go into council.
Yes, you could make a motion to amend in your council meeting, and there's no reason that it could not be adopted.
Okay.
You're not reading it now, you're discussing it.
Yeah, I just want to clarify Melody's question. I think she was saying, can they just add the language now and not have a motion to amend? But I think they're going to have to amend it on the floor.
Right? On a published agenda right now, so.
Right.
Okay.
Changing the agenda would require a vote anyway.
Okay. And then we can discuss what it should say. DeVita, that was from that Black March, Black Women's March. And that 91, is that in total over?
It was total.
Total.
Over many years?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, it's not clear, I think, so it should be.
So including a total of 91. Is that good? A total of 91 in Cleveland itself. Is that acceptable, Mary?
Let me see. So what I have is, well, I think it needs a time frame, including 91 in Cleveland itself over the course of, I don't know what the time frame is. Because the next it says 1,000 per year nationwide. And on a percent basis, as a percent of population, it is more Black, but there's actually more white people in those shootings than African American, than Black people. But I think it needs, so that's a national goal, but what is the, there aren't 91 killed in Cleveland in a year.
Not in a year, no, it's total. But David, do you have any background on timing?
Maybe just say since records were being kept or something like that.
Okay. Yeah, that's fine. It was mentioned at the march that Melody took the numbers from.
Well, I was concerned about fact checking that and making sure.
So including a total of 91 in Cleveland itself since records have been kept.
Okay.
Okay.
And as I mentioned, in Cleveland Heights of the recent killings of police officers dying in the line of duty, There was a white officer killed by an African-American who was mentally ill.
I think that might be a different subject.
Right, it is, but I'm not, we put anything about that in here. It's just, I don't think everybody was aware of that, so.
Okay.
So that, yeah, that would be fine.
Okay, so I'll move to amend that.
Okay, thank you.
Or you can if you like.
No, you can do it.
A second.
Oh, that's not actually happening right now.
If you need it, if you need the second, just to move it on, move it forward.
Okay, anything else on that particular piece of legislation? I can move on. All right, under the Administrative Services Committee, we have the third reading of 51-2020, which is an amendment to section 111.21 of the code, chapter 11, council, which allows council members to recuse themselves from voting due to a conflict of interest. The amendment was presented, it was discussed briefly at our last city council meeting. It's now in writing in the packet, just checking to see if there's any additional conversation or comments.
Does anybody have any concerns with the amendment?
Yeah, I guess my concern with the amendment is that the amendment is going to be brought forward as an amendment. So you can vote against the amendment and still vote for the legislation, correct?
Correct.
Wait.
Everybody okay? Okay. Next is a third reading for ordinance number 108-2019, which is amending chapter 749 fair practices to include non-consensual dissemination of a person's private sexual images as prohibited discriminatory rationale for the purposes of fair employment, education, and housing practices. Any comments, okay. Discussion on that?
So we got a memo from the law director basically saying that if we're going to do this, there is no better vehicle than the fair practices section. I know that there were some concerns about that. So if anybody wants to discuss that, I suppose we can discuss that now.
And well, the other question is whether we should do it at all, but yes. Oh,
we can vote on that.
Right.
Hey, this is Unger. I'm just coming in late. I apologize. I was in a all-day mediation. What was the question?
So just referring to the law director's memo about there being no better vehicle than the fair practices section to institute the discrimination legislation. I know that there were concerns about where in the code it could go. And the idea is that if we were to do this, if we decide to do this, then it doesn't make sense to put it somewhere else.
Right. I got that part, and I appreciate the law director's guidance on that. I guess I want to hear the law director's, and I apologize because I'm coming in late, if he's already I announced what his recommendation is with respect to this legislation, then ixnay on what I'm asking. But I'd like to hear the recommendation because it's important to me, and I think all legislation should be run past the law department before it's submitted to council.
So if that's for me, Mayor, and like for me to respond, I didn't make a recommendation thus far in the meeting, and as I think you know, I actually do not have a recommendation to make in terms of how council should vote, but I would have a procedural recommendation, which is that in furtherance of the question about whether this could be dealt with elsewhere in the code in an easier or better way, as Councilman Sarin indicated, I think this is probably the place that it would fit the best should council determine to take this step. And in particular, there had been some question about potentially building this into the criminal code. And I do recommend against trying to incorporate this type of activity within the scope of the criminal code. I think it raises many more questions than it answers, and would be essentially unenforceable and also demanding in terms of city resources in trying to make that process work.
The other thing, thank you for that, and I appreciate that. So the other question that I had asked, and perhaps others in fairness, was could you find an analog to this legislation in any other, you know, city or municipality in the country? For some reason, I was under the impression, and I may have misheard it or misread it, but I thought we had heard that New York City had some sort of analog, had adopted something similar to this. Were you able to find anything?
We did not locate an ordinance or a local regulation that would take the same approach. And there are some articles that I found in trying to get our arms around this, discussing the difficulty of trying to address the underlying behavior being first the dissemination of the unconsented to images, and second, the action by some third party based upon receipt of those improperly disclosed private images. And it appears to me that you could safely describe it as an area of a lot of discussion from a regulatory standpoint and from a victim protection standpoint. I've not identified any consensus out there in terms of a best practice on how to address this. Ohio, of course, has criminalized the act of the unauthorized disclosure, and in connection with that criminal action, there is the possibility for a civil action by the victim against the perpetrator, again, of the disclosure. We did not find another city or local government unit that had taken this same approach that would treat the entity relying upon that image for making some adverse employment or housing or education decision. It's possible that there is one out there, but it is certainly not something that's well established, and we couldn't find one.
I think the one thing that is confusing for the issue is that New York State's law that criminalizes the dissemination also provides that a victim can sue an employer for harassment if they're terminated because of it. And they can also, apparently landlords also can't discriminate based on tenants being victims. And so that's in the law that criminalizes the behavior as well. So it's tucked in there. So it's not a separate bill in New York.
Okay. Okay. So that may be what I was thinking of, Khalil. Thank you. And just so everybody knows, I did ask Khalil to provide me with some examples of what I would call real life discrimination by employers. And he did so, certainly to my satisfaction. Thank you for providing that information.
Sure, of course.
If there's nothing else, I'll move on. Well, next, under Community Relations and Recreation Committee, we have Resolution 79-2020, which is a resolution to support Ohio House Bill 535, also known as the Crown Act, which stands for creating a respectful and open workplace for natural care. Is there any conversation and discussion on that?
I just think it's lovely.
Okay.
I wish I had more of it.
All right. Municipal Services Committee is third reading of 54-2020, which is an ordinance amending Chapter 943, use of public ways for small cell wireless facilities and wireless support structures. I think we've discussed that. I think there's going to be probably some additional discussion during the council meeting. Just want to check in and see if
I think it's really important that, Bill, if you could do your explanation again, letting people know that, one, we don't have the option, that this is federally and state mandated, and that this helps protect them, and why it helps protect them, so that they understand that passage is actually more in what they're looking for than not passing.
And I'm presuming I have to introduce that, so I appreciate it if Bill could comment on that, because I think you know a lot more about it, Bill, than I do. Is that okay?
Okay. Yeah, sorry. I was pressing the unmute button unsuccessfully. So I think in order to keep this essentially shorter than particularly the one presentation that I provided for council, I would say and echo Councilwoman Hart's comment that the purpose of this ordinance is to amend an existing chapter of the Cleveland Heights Codified Ordinances. That chapter was initially adopted to protect the city to the maximum extent possible following the state of Ohio's adoption of a statute that reduced in some respects municipal authority over installing these facilities in the public right-of-way. And by facilities, I mean both antennas and poles or wireless support structures. But again, we wanted to comply with that law, but also make use of every bit of leverage and authority that we could under that framework. And shortly thereafter, the FCC issued its small cell order in the fall of 2018, such that in the spring of last year, 2019, we revisited Chapter 943 to accommodate the new restrictions that emanated from the FCC, which had to do with small wireless facilities being sort of smaller small cell facilities. And it really for the same purposes, to ensure that the city wasn't exposed to claims in state or federal court from wireless providers if an application was unlawfully denied or was not acted upon timely, and also to ensure that the city retained maximum possible control over locations, aesthetics, relocations, public awareness, and so forth for the benefit of residents. And in the process of dealing with some applications that came in within the last 6 or 8 months, we identified a couple of areas where we felt that the existing ordinance, now twice amended, or now adopted and amended, could be tweaked with a couple of minor further amendments just to have it function better with regard to installations of small cell facilities, which we believe may accelerate in the next year or so. There have been some public, a number of public comments about it, of course. And then we also received some comments from Verizon, which feels that the city is over-exercising its authority. I'm in the process of responding to that now, and would say only that while I think that they certainly read the ordinance is lawful and is appropriately calibrated to address this underlying subject. And the one issue that was raised in their letter having to do with the proposed relocation of facilities within the right-of-way, pushing them 100 feet or the width of the right-of-way itself, the ordinance could be read as allowing either antennas or poles to be subject to that authority. And the Ohio Revised Code is clear that that provision applies to poles, and so our application form makes that clear. And so the sum total of that is that we don't feel that there are any further amendments required to the ordinance. But of course, over time, as applications are received and processed by the city, it may be that we that we come back again and say, these certain trends have revealed themselves and we believe this is the appropriate way to handle it. And the industry is you know, on board or is opposed, but we nevertheless think that it's the right way to handle it and come back to council for further further treatment of the ordinance.
So I think what has to happen then is that I will introduce this legislation when the time comes and then say I support it. And Bill Hanna has done a great deal of research for us and as our law director, and I would like him to explain what he's discovered. Is that the right way to handle this, Tanisha and Jason?
Yes.
Okay.
Bill, and I wanna thank you again for explaining it. I did speak with several people as late as today. Vanessa Fitzgerald, matter of fact, was the last person I spoke to, resident, who was very concerned about it. And I explained it the way you explained it, but I don't think a lot of the residents understood it as it being a safety precaution and a benefit for them versus the opposite direction. So hopefully that explained it for her. She's supposed to be on listening to that explanation. So hopefully that cleared up some of the misinformation that people thought that this was more of a harm than a good thing for the residents of Cleveland Heights. So thank you for that explanation.
Sure. And it's definitely a complicated history and it's a complicated subject. So hopefully we can make that clear.
Definitely we needed you to explain it because I didn't know all of that information on sale. So thank you very much.
Yeah. Thank you, Bill, for all that good research.
Sure thing.
Thanks. So what's left is the consent agenda. Are there any items on the consent agenda that there are questions about?
Can I go back? I somehow this went by me when you were talking about ordinance 51-2020. You said there's an amendment to it. I didn't get that.
It was circulated via email a couple weeks ago now, I think.
Oh, several weeks ago.
Yeah, it's the amendment we discussed during the last council meeting, but we didn't get it until the day of the meeting. So it was determined to bring it up again tonight. We can, anybody confused about what the amendment does, explain it?
No, but can you explain to me again, if you did this before, I really apologize. I hate it when this is done to me. but if you went over this before, is there a way to vote for it without the amendment? I mean, is it only being off? Explain to me from a parliamentary procedure, Robert's rules standpoint, how the voting on that has to go, because I'm okay with it. I'm okay with it in concept without the amendment. I don't like the amendment.
Yeah, basically the way that it's gonna work is that the item will be read into the record and what normally happens is that somebody will move to approve it, then somebody will second it, and then there's a period of discussion. And during that discussion period, somebody will move to amend the legislation, somebody will second that. There will be a vote on the amendment, just the amendment, just the vote to amend. And then that will either pass or fail. And then once that amendment passes or fails, then the vote on the original item, either amended or not having been amended, then that vote happens to see whether or not it passes.
So and there, thank you for that. And therein lies the confusion here, because I guess what you're saying is now the amended version is what stands, that would be that which would be moved and seconded. And it's the amendment that I have
Only if the amendment passes. So if we we'll move the legislation and then somebody will move to amend it, and the amendment may or may not pass. If the amendment does pass, then we'll be voting on the amended version. If it doesn't pass, then we'll be voting on the original version.
But again, just to play further semantic games here, the amendment actually would be to remove the amendment. So I would have to move to amend the legislation without the amendment.
Legislation, Mike. The legislation is still as it stood. It has not, it does not reflect the amendment. The amendment is.
It has not yet been amended, to Tanisha's point. And so, and that process that Councilman Sarah described would follow. It has not been amended. There would, there could be a motion to amend it. If that motion passes, then you'd be voting on the amended ordinance. If that motion to amend fails, then you're voting on the original ordinance, which is what is on your agenda now.
But the original ordinance is the unstruck language sans the bold blue underline language in my document. Is that clear?
No. The original legislation is the one that allows for a recusal that does not require the unanimous consent of council. So that's the legislation. The legislation basically gives us the power to recuse without having to ask for unanimous consent.
That's what I'm in favor of.
Yeah, so that's the legislation that's in today's packet. The amendment adds a potential next step in case somebody wants to challenge that recusal.
And so what is this blue stuff? Is that
the- Yeah, so where's that clean version of the legislation that you just referred to, Khalil, in our packet? Because the only thing I have is a red line version, which obviously is very helpful, but it allows me to track the amended legislation, but not the original legislation. Where's the original legislation in my packet?
Is there anything at the top of the ordinance 51-2020 that you're looking at, Councilman?
Yes. It says proposed June 15th, third reading, okay, by council member Sarin. And then it's got both, you know, redactions and additions. It's got strikes and underlining. So I can follow what was struck.
Yes.
It's hard to read, but it's hard to read if you, I wish you were looking at exactly what I'm looking at, Bill, because it's hard to read out the added language, and it's hard to read in the struck language.
Hmm.
So if I read it with just the struck, with just the language that's been struck on the call for the ayes and nays, unless excused by the any member not being so excused, I don't know. That
is the struck language in the original ordinance, because the ordinance is an ordinance amending section 111-21.
Got it.
So that's the originally proposed amendment to 111-21.
Got it. Okay. But the answer is, just so I'm clear, there is no, we have only what we in the legal profession call a red line version of this. We don't have a clean version of the unamended ordinance in front of us in our council packet. Am I correct?
No, you never have, because remember, this is not brand new language. What was proposed was an amendment to existing language. That's what you see on the first page. The struck language reflects the amendment to the original chapter 111. The second piece that at the top of the document says proposed amended 51 is an additional amendment to the originally proposed amendment.
I don't have what you just read, Tanisha.
I don't have it either.
There's no way I could discern what you just said from the document that's in front of me.
That one was distributed before the last council meeting.
Well, I'm sorry, I look at the electronic packet, so it sounds like your paper packet may not have that amendment, but it was circulated via email. You've had the language. I'm happy to put it back on the screen if you want.
Is there any way before we vote on this that you could circulate a clean version of the ordinance without the redactions or additions to it, so we could just see what it looks like clean?
Is it okay if I just submit section one? Just email you guys section one?
Yeah, sure.
Okay.
Could you also email section one, the amended version?
I will try to do that. I'd have to look through my email to pull that up, but I'll give it a shot.
But that one, Melody, just FYI, if I'm understanding correctly, we have section one amended in hard copy in our packets.
I think she's talking about the amendment to the amendment.
Ah, I see. Okay.
Which, you know, it might help to clarify for the viewing public, what question were we trying to answer as proposed an amendment to the amendment? Melody?
Yeah, okay. So the question we were trying to answer is, if a person recuses themselves for a reason that they say is conflict of interest or some other ethics or something, and there are council members who do not believe that that is a conflict of interest, that someone could say they don't believe it's a conflict of interest, and then you would take a vote. But it only occurs if someone actually challenges that. I know that, as Khalil pointed out, this language, you could still do that by using a parliamentary procedure. What was it, point of order or something like that? Except that, who's going to remember that 5 years from now? You have people on council, it's like, they're not going to know the parliamentary procedure is to say point of order.
Well, I don't think we advise us. Bill, you can correct me if I'm wrong, but I don't think we advise council typically to rely on Robert's rules or parliamentary procedure if we can codify it.
Yeah, that's why I prefer it codified, because I felt that nobody's going to remember all that for parliamentary procedure.
Go ahead, Bill.
Well, no, I was just going to echo what you said, that I think that is a correct statement of how that would play out under Robert's rules. And that's the conversation that was had a few weeks back. But in order to avoid circuitous, confusing discussions of what the procedure is, the thought was, even though it's a few more words, by codifying that, to your point, life should be easier for council if and when this issue does present itself.
What would be easier?
Navigating this process of recusal.
With the amendment or without the amendment?
With the amendment. The original ordinance, which is an ordinance amending section 111.21, provides that the member can indicate that they have an interest in a matter or a conflict, or that they can't vote on it based upon the ethics laws, and they'll disclose that, and then the process is over. What's not, and they don't have to vote. What's not clear is, what if someone else on council thinks that is an illegitimate or an untruthful explanation or reason? And there is a procedure under Robert's rules that could be invoked to address that. The thought process, working through it, was that we could codify that procedure and actually make it more tailored to this ordinance, so that you would have a roadmap for having that conversation in the event that somebody moves to recuse, articulates their conflict or concern, and another member of council has concerns about that explanation and wants to have the full council vote. So that's what's broken out in the proposed amended 51-2020.
The one we're looking at? Or the other one?
You have to be more specific. One does not say, one says proposed amended 51-2020.
They don't have that one in their paper packet, and right, they're looking at the paper packet. I don't think anyone has their electronic packet open, so that's the
problem. Okay. So the one that you have then does not break it out in detail.
So I'm not clear on which one we're voting on then.
Okay, so
we're not sure either. What's going to have to happen is that the one that is currently before council, that's been read into the record already, is the current version, the original version. That original version, after it gets its reading and is moved and seconded, someone will move to amend it with the version that includes your provision.
Oh, I see.
And so that movement to that move to amend will be voted on. And then either that amendment to this legislation will pass or fail. And then after that either passes or fails, we'll then vote on the final version of the legislation.
Okay, so when if someone wants to amend, do they have to have this amendment in front of them so that they can read it? And say they're want to amend it by saying XYZ?
Yeah, that's
yeah, we can get that. We can get that to you. I don't know if I can get a clean version as Mike requested.
Well, I was going to just type it up and send it out.
Yeah, that's fine.
So I'm doing that now.
Oh, okay. Yeah, whatever it's easiest.
We could also, another option would be to do nothing here. We don't have to do anything. We've got it. It's in the code. We've been able to survive with it. To the best of my recall, I was the protagonist of this. I regret doing so. Now we've now spent more time discussing it in terms of the fix than we ever had to spend in terms of time at council voting on my request to recuse myself. I was just frustrated. I just didn't think that if any member of council, be it me or Jason or Khalil or anybody else, says I need to recuse myself from this. It never frankly occurred to me that anybody would do so in order to avoid a hot issue. In fact, I think this council moves the opposite way and it's more than willing to embrace hot issues. It was designed to be a time-saving move based on my familiarity with how other organizations work. But I can assure you, it wasn't so cumbersome. All you do is you say, hey, I need to recuse myself from this thing. And then someone makes a motion to allow you to recuse yourself. And then it usually passes unanimously without any issue. Frankly, I can't recall any issue. So frankly, I think I'm leaning in favor. This has become such a mess, not due to anybody's fault, it just has. And I think I'm in favor of just leaving it alone. This council has never had any difficulty in dealing with it as it's drafted, and getting into this kind of complexity is unnecessary given the issue as I see it. It was meant to be administratively efficient, more efficient, not less efficient.
Well, we will, I guess, have the opportunity to figure out whether or not we want to do this.
Right.
Any other questions on the consent agenda? Okay. So I'm going to shuffle some stuff around as someone needs to make a motion to go into executive session.
Thanks, Tanisha. We're not done yet.
I completely forgot about the mask. Got distracted by recusal language. I'm sorry. Go ahead, Jason.
No, you can lead the discussion. It's your show.
Okay. As we know, our transmission rate in Cuyahoga County, in the state, and specifically in County Cuyahoga County and six other counties throughout the state, is surging at a rapid pace. There is a lot of concern from our public health officials, particularly our Cuyahoga County Board of Health officials, about the danger for our residents. And we're seeing this across the state, where cities are starting to put mandates in place for mask wearing, because scientifically proven, our public health experts support that one of the ways in which we can try to control the virus and its spread is by wearing masks or face coverings. So you're starting to see cities take individual action in lieu of the state's decision not to mandate masks statewide. There's been some action in Dayton. There's been action in Columbus, Cleveland. Several other cities are considering action. I believe there are some council members that are interested in taking action to mandate masks here in Cleveland Heights. And we had some discussion about that over the weekend. And I want council to know some of the information that I have at this point in time. So one, the county, I believe, has pursued, or at least county executive is planning to introduce legislation to mandate masks countywide. It does not appear, we're not sure where that's going to go, given that the county council needs to act on it. The best timeline I have comes from conversations with county officials, where it appears as though if it is introduced tomorrow, it will likely go to committee and have the best chance. If it is going to pass, it could be a couple of weeks from now. And we know that every day is important. I also spoke today with five other communities. We have a small regional group of Eastside communities that work together regularly on issues, including working together on our coordinated response to COVID-19. Those other five cities, if there's not going to be a statewide mandate, and there's potentially not going to be a countywide mandate, we're trying to find a way to get to some uniformity so that at least in our little region of the county, people might know what to expect and we might be able to increase compliance. And so those six cities are interested in working together. I know Beachwood is currently having this same discussion tonight. They have draft legislation that they are considering and having that conversation tonight during their council meeting. So we'll see what comes out of that. But essentially, we're trying to have some of these requirements be uniform, whether it be the minimum age that we require the mask, where we require the mask be worn. Of course, we're not trying to create burden for the community, but we want to make sure we're doing things to protect our residents. And at this point, we know that mask wearing is one of those things that is effective. And if we can encourage compliance with that, we might be able to bring the virus transmission under control. So we're working on some legislation. I think I'm looking at Bill. Did something come through, Bill?
Not yet. I'm sorry. I have a piece of draft general legislation based upon Dayton and Cincinnati that I can send over, but it is not in a form that's ready for council action.
So what if you have seen the Dayton ordinance, and certainly on our call earlier today with the other five communities, we had Terry Allen from the Cuyahoga County Board of Health join us on that call. Just help us as we think through what these requirements should be and make sure we're in line with their guidance. He did mention that the Dayton model was a good one to take a look at. And so we are modeling our legislation after the Dayton model. I believe Executive Buttigieg's legislation is also similarly or closely modeled after the Dayton model. But if you're thinking about if county passes something, does it supersede the city? That's not the case. So the city's legislation would actually supersede the county. And if the county does move forward, I think cities will have an opportunity to opt out, and you might see some of that. My understanding is that the county has received some calls on this. I know the executive has, and so it's assumed that county council members have as well. Most of the calls have been in opposition to a mandate for masks. So if that gives you any indication of how this might shake out, through the legislative process at the county, I think it's imperative that we act locally, and that if we can do so in a coordinated fashion with our neighbors, I think that's all the better. And so it would be my recommendation that we proceed with drafting legislation that would require masks in our community with very few exceptions, but reasonable exceptions, obviously. And because we're not ready to do that tonight and time is of the essence, we would suggest that this council agree to have a special meeting this week so that we might be able to move this forward and get it in place as soon as possible.
Tanisha, has anyone said how would this affect the ADA laws?
No, so certainly there are exceptions made for those who, there are all sorts of exceptions, actually. Bill, do you have the Dayton or one of the ordinances open that you might be able to quote from the exception?
I do. Bear with me here a moment.
I just looked it up, but now I can't find it. But there would be accommodation for those who would have difficulty wearing the mask. There would be those who could not wear a mask as a function of their job.
Do you want me to recite quickly some of the exceptions in the Dayton ordinance?
Yes, thank you.
The requirement to wear a face covering under this ordinance does not apply in the following situations. Any individual who cannot wear a face covering because of a medical condition, mental health condition, or developmental disability, or who is unable to remove the face covering without assistance, and any individual who should not wear face coverings under the CDC's guidance. An individual is not required to produce medical documentation of the condition or disability, provided that an employer may require such documentation from an employee in accordance with state and federal law. B, individuals under 6 years old. C, restaurant and bar patrons while eating and drinking. If a patron is not seated at his or her table or at the bar, a face covering is required. There's a provision on schools so that they can follow the regulations under the Ohio Department of Education. To the extent that those are promulgated in settings where not practicable or feasible to wear a face covering, such as when receiving dental services, medical treatments, or while swimming, walking or exercising outdoors, so long as physical separation of not less than 6 feet is maintained, or while walking or exercising outdoors with other members of the same household, while actually engaged in exercising in a gym or other similar indoor facility, so long as physical separation of not less than 6 feet is maintained, and the individual wears a face covering at all times when not actually engaged in exercising, when an individual is in his or her workspace, conference room, or other workspace not intended for use by the general public, when inside a personal or commercial vehicle, either parked or moving, that is not otherwise described, like Uber, individuals while acting in their official capacity as a public safety employee or emergency responder, when wearing a face covering would interfere with or limit their ability to carry out their official functions or duties, including police officers, firefighters, and other public safety or emergency medical personnel that support public safety operations. And that's the gist of the list.
Could you tell me, Tanisha, what are the six communities that you consult with?
So I'll mention a few of them. I think they're all in various stages. So I'll just mention. Certainly Shaker Heights is moving forward, wanting to pass something that has some uniformity. University Heights as well. I know that South Euclid is also interested. There's several other communities. So we're all trying to, you know, create a little region, if you will, of uniformity, which we think will enhance compliance and try to cut down on some of the confusion of going to 59 separate municipalities and having different versions of this or none at all. Until that's addressed either countywide or statewide, it certainly appears that localities need to take some action right now.
Okay, thank you.
Wait, just really quick. You said South Euclid, Shaker, obviously University Heights. Did you mention Beechwood earlier?
Beechwood is currently having this conversation. If it's
potentially.
Yep. Okay. Their meeting started.
And was that it or?
No, there are others. They're just, they're in various stages of discussions.
So we don't know necessarily if they're, okay.
So Tanisha, everything you said makes really good sense to me. And I thank you for your due diligence on this hot topic. I'm just curious, did Terry Allen or anyone from the county opine on the wisdom of this sort of, you know, region of uniformity. Did they indicate that it's a good idea? I guess, and just for those that might wonder why I would care what Terry Allen and the county think, as we all know, we don't have our own health department. We're not like the city of Cleveland or other big cities. We look to Terry Allen and the county Board of Health for any and all enforcement, or most enforcement, I should say, in our region. So their guidance is relevant to me, not perhaps dispositive, but relevant on the topic. And yeah. I agree with you, the Dayton model sounds like a really good one. So I'm glad to hear that this group is looking at it and the county is looking at it.
Thank you for that question, Mike. Terry certainly expressed some concern that there's going to be a patchwork of regulation. And, you know, we sort of concluded that it doesn't appear that there's a way around that. I don't think any of us have given up on that. I know Mayor Brennan spoke to Cheryl Stevens earlier, and she said that she is receiving a lot of opposition correspondence. And so any letters that you all might be willing to write to our county council representatives would be helpful. We are all still pushing on the governor as well, because we think a statewide mandate would be the best solution, or at least a hybrid approach where he's now introduced this new color code alert system of yellow, orange, red, and purple. And we're, of course, a red county. If you could at least tie the mandate to the color code system, you know, at least that provides some flexibility, because I think he's getting a lot of pressure from rural areas and other places in the state who feel they should not have to have the same kinds of restrictions in place and mandates in place where the virus is transmitting at a higher rate. I don't think public health officials agree with that, but we certainly can sympathize with the politics around that conversation. But we have to find a way to set politics aside. This is about public health and safety. This is about keeping our residents safe, especially those that are most vulnerable, that may pick up this virus from someone who's asymptomatic, and they would be able to avoid that situation if that person was wearing a mask. So Terry is concerned that there's going to be a patchwork, but at the same time, we agree that something is better than nothing. And if communities can try to coordinate and at least create a region, it's better than not doing so. So that was the feedback that we got from him.
So let me just react to very quickly to one thing that you said. I like everything that you said. I'm not sure that Governor DeWine is going to read my personal letter to him urging him to adopt face masks. However, if my colleagues agree, I would love to see a letter on Cleveland Heights letterhead signed by as many of our council colleagues as could sign on, and you as our city manager urging Governor DeWine to do precisely what you just articulated. So, and if joined with other communities, all the better. I like that idea very much.
We can certainly do that. And I suggested to our little mayors and manager group earlier today for the six communities that we think about including that language in the legislation itself as well.
I think that's so wonderful. That we might send a copy. I can only speak for myself, but I think it's a wonderful idea, and I'm on board.
Yeah.
That's essentially what you might see in our draft. I think we'd like to hear from you about other concerns. If you've reviewed the Dayton draft, if you have any ideas or concerns, I want to point out that the health department is not in a position to enforce this mandate for us. So there will be local enforcement. And even if there's a countywide ban or a statewide mandate, not ban, if there's a mandate, it will still be up to local enforcement. And we understand that, but we certainly think it's worth it at this point.
So I've got the executive's proposed ordinance, and my understanding is that it will be introduced as a walk-on tomorrow. I don't know when exactly it will be, or it might currently be public. I don't know if he's published it or not. But we could potentially look at it and adhere as closely to it as we feel comfortable doing, so as not to create that patchwork that we're concerned about, so that when the county's regulation does come into effect, if it does, then everything will be the same and people should expect the same treatment no matter what city they go in the county. Is at least an option for us to consider.
We're certain. I actually just received a copy of that. I don't know if it's public either, but I did receive a copy of it. And so I'm going to share that with Bill. My understanding is that it was designed to closely model Dayton, which we were already doing. So that's good news, and that I don't think we'll find too many inconsistencies.
There's at least one thing in here that I've got my own opinions. One thing that I think that if we impose something, there's some changes that I would want to see from what I'm seeing.
Well, let's not get into it now because we got other things to
do. Yeah.
But it would also be helpful if you want to share that now or later. Again, if we're going to have a special meeting this week with the expectation that you all take action this week, then we need you to be comfortable with the aspects of the legislation. So if there are hard stops for you, please let us know. Or sort of guardrails, if you will, if that works mm-hmm. better. Let us know what those are as Bill is currently drafting the legislation. We want to circulate it to you as soon as we can so that we can try to move this forward soon and get people safe sooner.
Okay.
Do we want to find a day this week for that already now, or is
I don't think we should do it now because that could take forever, and some people have scheduling assistance, so we will task Jennifer with that first thing in the morning.
Sounds good, thanks.
Okay. Mayor Stein, did I cover everything?
Yeah, I believe so.
Okay.
We're ready for the executive session.
Yeah, I'm going to move some staff around while someone makes the motion. Amy will call the roll, and then you see us all go away.
I move that we go into executive session to consider the appointment of a public official.
Second.
Hey, please call the roll.
Dunbar?
Aye.
Hart?
Aye.
Russell?
Aye.
Saren?
Aye.
Stein?
Aye.
Unger?
Aye.
Six approvals, Your Honor.
Okay, we are back. Let me get to. Okay, everyone's back. We want to continue with the Committee of the Whole, Mayor, or what is your...
Yes, we will continue the Committee of the Whole. I believe the next point, hopefully it'll be fairly short and straightforward. And then I do want to still move on to the fourth agenda item, which we won't go in deep into the explanation, but I do want you to let Council know what that section is about.
Okay, sounds great. So the next item on the Committee of the Whole agenda is the charter amendment. So essentially there's some issues with the dates around pulling petitions for those who would be interested in running for mayor next year. Those issues they need to be clarified, and essentially they are a part of the charter amendment that changed the form of government. And it's Bill Hanna's recommendation that they be clarified before next year's timeframe in order to pull petition, which would mean this November. So Bill, I'll just turn it over to you for a quick, rundown of what this is and how quickly council would need to move.
Okay, thank you, Tanisha. So this issue was initially brought to my attention by Len Friedson, and he called out the changes that issue 26 made to Article 7 of the Charter with respect to municipal elections. And the real issue comes down to the possibility that a primary election would be required for the office of mayor if more than two candidates are certified as qualified for that election. And so that's fine. There's a primary election that's to be held in that instance on the second Tuesday after the first Monday in September. The problem is that in section 7-3E of the Charter, which is called Petition for Places on Ballots, the current language, which was not changed by issue 26, provides that nominating petitions can be signed by electors not more than 180 days prior to such election, which was at that point in time referring to the November municipal election, and not less than 90 days prior to such election. And so as a result of, first of all, the use of the term such election, it's not clear whether you might be referring to a primary election or the regular municipal election. And then if you were to go with the interpretation that that refers to the November election, you're looking at nominating petitions for mayors, mayoral candidates rather, being submitted potentially 30 days prior to a primary election, which is not, which is also not really a feasible timeframe. And so I provided to council just this afternoon a couple of excerpts from other communities' charters that I pulled that addressed this question when they have a primary election process that takes place based upon the number of candidates for office. And in both of those cases, they tie the timetable for collecting and submitting slash filing petitions to the primary election. And in each of those cases, they provide that petitions need to be filed not less than 90 days prior to that primary election. And that is the excerpt from the City of Springfield Charter and from the City of Green Charter. And my recommendation, as Tanisha said, would be that I think Len and CEM are correct that there is this issue that ought to be addressed. It would certainly be better if it were addressed prior to the first election for mayor post issue 26. And I think it would be a matter principally of just building in a time frame, probably very similar to the time frame in those two examples, that would allow the collection and filing of petitions sufficiently far in advance of the primary election date. You may or may not have a primary election depending upon how many candidates are certified, but nevertheless, if you use that date, then the rest of it flows through in a time frame that works for the process.
You're on mute, Mary.
Yeah, you're on mute.
I'm not quite clear on why there needs to be a primary, because is this changing us to a partisan form of government as opposed to what we currently have, which is nonpartisan?
No, it's not partisan. What it does is it whittles the field down from whoever has thrown their hat in the ring down to the two primary candidates. So, yeah, after the primary, there will be, out of the larger field, the top two will go on to the general.
Got it.
So are there any questions about the timeline and the process? Oh, go ahead, Bill.
Thank you. I may have neglected to point out that if council should choose to do this, it would need to pass legislation to send this to the Board of Elections and send it to the Board of Elections not later than 4 o'clock on September 4th, 60 days prior to the November 3rd election this year.
And so from a functional standpoint, and maybe I missed it, but so if we're basing the timeframe on the September specifically and making that clear, what's the date or the two dates, the 180 and 90 days? What approximate dates are we looking at? Was that 6 months or something? 6 months and then three months?
Three and six, right, essentially.
Okay.
And what I did not try to sketch out, not having had this conversation with council yet, or following up further with Len Friedson, was addressing that time frame with regard to petitions for council elections. But I don't think that's overly problematic.
All right, so Bill, you can put something together and have that legislation ready for our next meeting?
Sure.
Okay. All right. You're on mute, Tanisha.
Thanks. Thank you. The final agenda item is legislation process and deadlines. Just wanted to tee up a conversation about creating a process and some structure around legislation introduction by council members. So as you all are aware, the code doesn't really provide a lot of guidance. It does sort of lay out a basic procedure, but typically, city councils will adopt some rules in addition to that, what's minimally found in the codified ordinances, in order to create a structure and a process that everyone understands. And on the other side of that equation is a process that would facilitate efficiency on the administrative side of the equation. So as the legal review needs to happen, and if the legislation impacts the operation of the organization, that would also need to have some time for processing. So in those of you who are not new to council, remember that there's been a few bites at this apple of trying to come up with some agreeable process around which legislation gets moved forward when it's developed and proposed by an individual member of council. And so there's a large booklet that's in draft form that you guys were reviewing, but there are pieces of that booklet that I think, pieces of the guidelines that warrant some additional conversation if you're not going to or not prepared yet to move those council guidelines forward. And this would be one of them. It certainly seems that we're in a new era, if you will, of legislation being proposed by members of council. And so we need to adjust our practices, I think, so that we can better facilitate that process. So we have some ideas. There's certainly lots of communities near us and across the country that provide really good models for us to reflect upon. I know Bill has worked in other communities and currently works in other communities where there's some structures in place. So there's a lot for us to consider. Didn't want to do that tonight, just wanted to I guess gauge if there was some appetite to do that. It would really be helpful to get a structure in place, because as we try to prioritize our work, it's difficult as pieces of legislation come at us different times. We have to try to determine what's the priority and how we evaluate that. Typically, things get pushed off so that we can accommodate whatever that piece is that the council member is trying to move forward at that particular time. So it would be helpful to put some timeframes in place, some guidance around, you know, how we spend our staff time. So does it, if we're going to do a review and spend time on something, even from a council perspective, if there's not another person who's willing to even second that piece of legislation, you know, that could help us sort of prioritize how we go about our work. So those are the kinds of issues that I think would be really helpful for us to discuss. and to try to build a structure that around the process that makes sense and helps facilitate a good flow for everyone from the council member to the staff.
I think we absolutely do, because we've set priorities for council and we get, I feel that we get distracted by sometimes less important things. So I would very much support having that conversation.
I think some guidelines are probably helpful, because I don't know what guidelines, you know, when I'm putting forth that legislation, I don't know what works for the administration or I know what the priorities are, but yeah, I think some guidelines would be good. Nothing to discourage legislation, but something to kind of guide along the way of how it would get proposed and how the timeline is, you know, what the timeline could be.
I agree with Melody, Mary, and Tanisha. Not only this, it's not only this council's desire to at least look at this. It was the last council's desire to look at this. Hopefully, Tanisha or Mary. I think Mary did the lion's share of the work on this. We looked at other council operating, maybe it was Carol Rowe, I don't remember, but something was distributed that looks a lot like what you are talking about. Others on this call probably remember it. I don't remember the date, but I know it's out there and it's already, you know, someone needs to dust it off and recirculate it again. It's dealing with this exact issue, and I agree wholeheartedly.
So we would discuss this at another council, committee of the whole?
Yeah. I agree. Good idea.
Correct. Yeah. Next committee of the whole, we would discuss it more in depth.
That's great. And so I guess I wanted to make sure there's no strong objection to it, and we can, I'll work with Jason to get it on the agenda. We'll circulate some examples again. I'm not operating under the impression that you all want to take another stab at the guidelines as a whole. I mean, that was a large document. But we're just going to focus on this particular process right now.
Sure. Okay. I'm almost sure, Tanisha, that if you find that document, there was a section that dealt with introducing, and if a memory serves, we borrowed, to be polite about it, from someplace in Colorado, I think.
Fort Collins.
That's it. Thank you. It was Fort Collins, Colorado.
Yeah, it's all burned in my brain. We all did a lot of work on that.
Right, we did a ton of work on it and it went nowhere, but maybe it'll go somewhere this time.
Yeah, let's do part of it.
May I add to that discussion? Could you also can we also have a discussion on how council navigate through staff so that we're correct on how we navigate properly? Being new on council, sometimes we're not navigating correctly and may not be aware of that. So some conversation around that would be very helpful as well.
Vita, all I can say, it's dictated by charter. I mean, it's right there in black and white. I'll be happy to sit down and go over it with you, but I know right where it is. It's right behind me where I'm sitting right now. But it's very clear and very declarative on what we can and cannot do as a council.
Correct. I've read that, but I think interpretation is to each person's desire. When asking a question could be viewed as making a demand versus asking a question. So I just want to be clear just to make sure. Thank you.
Okay.
Okay, any objection to adding those two topics? I'm happy to develop a protocol that we all agree upon for both of those things.
Go for it.
Sounds good.
Okay. Great.